Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Well, good evening, everyone, and welcome to this meeting of the County Commissioners, May 20th, 2013. Prior to the official beginning of the meeting, I'm going to ask Vice Chair Bill Lashley if he will offer our invocation.
Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we pause at this time at the end of the day, thanking you for being in our lives, thanking you for blessing this nation, and we ask for your guidance in everything we say and do at this meeting tonight. May we do the people's business and do it in the best humor we can. In your holy name we pray. And also, I'd like to ask for a moment of silent prayer for those victims from Oklahoma. Amen.
Thank you, Bill. Also, I'd like to announce Linda Massey is not with us tonight. She had a fall today and may have broken her hip. She is at ARMC. We got her permission to discuss this, and she just said that she missed everybody and be back soon, but they're going to at least keep her, I think, in the hospital overnight. She fell and apparently may have broken her hip. At this time, Bruce, I'm going to ask you if you would have your Boy Scouts help us with the pledge tonight. However you want to conduct that would be fine.
These are Boy Scouts and
troops from 167 Mount Vernon Rock Creek Church. So let's stand. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. At this time we have the public comment period of our meeting. I do want to mention, if you are here to participate in the public hearing involving the consolidation proposals and options with the Department of Social Services and the Department of Public Health, it is not necessary for you to have signed up here. We will have a public hearing and we'll allow everyone to speak. So these are the folks I have that wish to speak about other items than the public hearing. And the first speaker I'd like to call is Mr. Frank Bell. Mr. Bell? Welcome, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First of all, I think a thank you is in order to you guys and Ms. Massey for your work and appropriations for those people necessary to making a reevaluation or evaluation for us in 2017. Things are in motion to accomplish that, and it's very important that we did that at this present time, and that is ongoing. And thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I have talked, we too have shared those sentiments and along with you other board members, and thank you for that move that has allowed us to move forward to try to make this county one of the most sought after places to live and to raise our kids. Tonight I'd like to talk about another subject. The subject that I'd like to talk about tonight is about the chairman. I want it clearly understood tonight that there has been some errors and some things happened in this man's life that he's not proud of. I'm not condoning anything of those items that he has done. I want that understood to start with. I want you to also understand that I'm a Christian man, and I believe that the Lord gave me a second chance. And if it wasn't for a second chance, I wouldn't be here tonight. And I want you to consider, me and this gentleman has had long conversations about the problems, the addictions, and the things that he has been involved in. He has revealed to me that he is willing and has asked his Lord to forgive him of those sins and is wants to make a new life for himself. I hope that you find it in your minds and in your hearts tonight to consider giving this man a second chance. I'm not concerned about what's politically correct. I'm concerned about what's correct with the man upstairs. And if this gentleman has confessed of his sins and wants to become the man that we thought he ought to have been to start with, then I think it necessary that we give him an opportunity to do that. I know there's disappointments. I have a letter from him that shares those disappointments. But folks, if you find it in your heart to forgive him, I think he's worthy of a second chance. If you don't find it in your heart to give him a second chance, I leave you with this statement. Where would you be and where would I be if we had not gotten a second chance? Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Brown. Our next speaker is Lash Reitenberry. Mr. Reitenberry, welcome.
Well, I was hoping Frank would stick around for a minute because I had three chances. But, Mr. Chairman, I just want to publicly thank Sheriff Johnson and the Alamance County Sheriff's Department for the fantastic job that they did at my friend and Masonic brother, Chief of Police in Gibsonville, Mike Wasnick. I'll put the Alamance County Sheriff's Department up against any department, not only in this state, in this nation. They did a fantastic job, very professional, and I think it's time to reward them. We all should be proud of what we have. This man has took, and some of you may not agree, but a mediocre sheriff's department and turned it into one of the most elite departments in the nation. He's well respected across this nation. His men need a raise. Look at the salaries they make. But not only his men, county employees need a raise. There's some county employees, I don't know how in the world they make it. Just take time to walk around some of the offices and talk to some of these folks. They get furloughed. That knocks them in the head. But just stop and think. If you give them a raise, and you raise our sheriff's deputies up, they're going to spend money. They may go buy a new house. They may go buy a new car. They're going to spend more money on groceries. We got a low tax rate in Alamance County, but I don't see people beating the door down to get here to build a new business. We are a bedroom community. Tax rate doesn't have anything to do with what's going on in Alamance County. I don't want to pay any more taxes either. We were at 58 cents. We came down to 52 cents. I don't want to see it go back up to 58, but I think we need to raise taxes. And I think that's the only way out of it. But we need to take care of our county employees. And we need to take care of our sheriff's department. And I appreciate your time.
Thank you, guys. Our next speaker is Tony Cox. Mr. Cox, saw you earlier. Is he in the other room?
Yeah, sorry about that. I got here too late.
Good evening, sir. Welcome.
You know, at the last meeting, I told everybody I want to do better, right?
Okay. There's been a history of people coming in this room right here and telling lies on me. I am scared to run my plumbing business, affordable plumbing service and repair. Clyde Albright, county attorney, represented on August 17, 2007, that I could never run affordable plumbing service and repair until I was licensed. That was a lie. Okay? I begged, I pleaded, Mr. Engel, tonight, I built a yard. Y'all said that I couldn't do what I done in 2007. You wasn't here, Mr. Engel, you were sick. People come in this room and they lied. You should have heard them. I went, how far is the salvage yard that I built out there next to you? About from here to Elm Street down there?
It's probably 3/4 of a mile.
Never heard me. Fine job. 5 months. Closed on it December 2007, April 10th. I got the permits to operate it. Scrap land. I'm tired of people lying on me. I'm tired of people lying about me, and I'm tired of people lying to me. Crimes was committed against me in this room. Crimes was committed against Deborah Prince in this room. You know it. Everybody else that's involved in it knows it. Get it straight. I think I've done everything under the law to show the lies, the cheats, the thieves that y'all, you said that night, Mr. Lashley, you said this is nothing but a play on words, right?
Mm-hmm, that's correct.
Lie, 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 and you went for it. And you talk about how good you do.
Don't look at me and start that garbage.
You're a punk.
See me after the meeting. We'll talk about it further if you think you can
straighten
handle
it out.
I'll be out there.
Joke.
I'm sorry.
I'd like to call on Ms. Ann Kasserbaum. Mm-hmm. Ms. Kasserbaum?
Yes.
Welcome to you.
My name is Ann Kasserbaum. I live in Alamance County. I'm a member of the Human Relations Council. I do not speak for the Human Relations Council tonight. We haven't had a chance to meet since the information came out in the press today. But I'm here because I was here a few months ago when you rejected Scott Zienti for membership in the Human Rights Council. He's a person who's been very active on behalf of Latinos in this county, a person who's worked to see that they're treated fairly. So I was told when I was here 2 months ago that there was no place on the council for people with a political agenda. That conversation is on videotape, and I believe it's online. The next month, someone with a clear political agenda was appointed to the council, and tonight you consider another person who has a clear and active political life in Alamance County. I won't refer to their politics. Some people are concerned that they cannot work toward the mission of fairness and compassion for all people in Alamance County. But I don't know that. I'm not telling you not to approve them. But I am asking you to honor your stand. If it is inappropriate for people in Alamance County to have a political position and be on the Human Rights Council, then I think you need to revisit your decision about the membership of Scott Zienti. Let me describe to you what the goal of the Human Relations Council is as we present it in our brochure for the public. We take pride in Alamance County and want to make it stronger. Communities thrive when people work together and enjoy security and diversity. Businesses want to establish themselves in places where their employees will be treated fairly and have healthy, interesting lives. We seek to make Alamance County a better place. We welcome any member who is concerned about all people living in Alamance County. So please reconsider your stand and be consistent. We all need to be fair and we all need to be compassionate. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Kaiserbaum. And Ms. Ernestine Lewis. Is Lewis in the other room as well? Good evening, Ms. Lewis. Welcome.
Good evening, Mr. Manning, Chairman of the Alamance County Commissioner and Board Members. I have my Bible with me tonight.
Good.
Some of
you
know me. I say what I mean and mean what I say. So I'm going to be brief and to the point because I wrote it out. And I have a copy for you. The Alamance County National Association for the Advancement of Colored People opposes Stephen Carter's nomination to the Human Relations Council. The Time News stated that Mr. Carter had never attended a meeting of the Human Relations Council. That shows that he had no interest in some of the citizens of Alamance County. The commissioner rejected Scott Zini, who passed services showed that he had a heart for people. It is clear that some citizens chose to ask him to be on the board because his involvement with the Tea Party. We are asking you to think before you vote on Stephen Carter for a member of the Human Relations Council. Thank you for allowing me to be heard. Ernestine Lewis, President of Alamance County NAACP. You know, we have a lot of problems here in this county, and we need someone that's going to represent all people.
Thank you. That concludes this portion of the public comments. I'm going to begin the commissioner responses by taking personal privilege, and I appreciate Mr. Bell's comments, but I do want to offer a very public apology to a very personal situation. I know that I have disappointed many people, many in this room. I have saddened many in this room and many folks who have counted on me to lead Alamance County. Most of all, I have really hurt my family, my wife, my kids, my stepkids, and that's damage that is permanent. My top priority right now is to do everything I can do to rebuild and hopefully reconcile with my family, and that's not going to be an easy thing to do. I also want to apologize to my fellow commissioners if any of my comments were taken in a way, in a personal way, as an attack. That certainly was never my intent. And I do apologize for that. As Mr. Bell said, I do plan, and I am in the process of getting the help and assistance that I need to deal with my personal issues and my personal situation, my personal problems. In the past, I have asked for your support. Right now, I'm asking for your thoughts and your prayers. And I thank you for allowing me to take this minute to convey that. As I said, my number one priority is to try to make amends with my family. Thank you. Other responses?
My God tells me that I need to accept that on face value, and I accept it. Good luck.
Thank you.
I also will accept that.
Thank you, Bill. Do we have other responses at this time or to any of the other speakers?
I'd like to say something about Tony. I'm sorry I sort of blew up there, but I don't know what got into him. We shouldn't let him, in my opinion, get so boisterous. But he's called my house here recently and wanted me to help him. I've talked to him. We've never had cross words. I don't know what happened. Evidently, I didn't look pretty enough for him or something. But Jason Martin knows that I approached Jason here about a week ago, and we talked about Tony. And we said, look, Tony's still upset that we didn't approve something for him that he wanted approved back when it didn't meet certain guidelines. And Jason admitted to me that the rules were different now, and he assured me that if Tony approached them again, and I told Tony, I said, look, if you've got something you want us to address, bring it back to the right people, and you'll be treated again accordingly. I thought everything was hunky-dory, and I don't know what happened here tonight. I apologize for jumping on him the way I did, but I didn't like being talked to that way, so, you know, that's just the way I am. So.
Well, I think Tony has a good point of view. Because this county bankrupted him. It destroyed, you know, his credibility and his livelihood. I can understand how he feels like he does. And I don't think he should blame you or anybody in particular, because at the time, we did what the law allowed us to do.
Yeah. And those rules have changed.
Those rules have changed. Yeah. So,
well, thank you, Tim. And Bill, I'm not versed on his background and situation to the extent y'all are, and certainly trust your comments and judgment on that. Any other responses? This time we will, commissioners, please review for approval of the agenda, which would include items on the consent agenda. We do have a couple of things. In front of you are two resolutions. One has to do with a resolution in support of the sale of the assets of the Townsend Umatron, I think it's a chicken facility. Where's Henry? Henry, if you can come in here for a minute.
You got Henry Fives.
Yes, and he brought this to our attention, and I'd like to add it either to consent agenda or the regular agenda as an item to discuss. Henry, if you'll just stand there a minute. And maybe you can explain this to us when let me get through the approval of the agenda first, I'm sorry. And then the second one was an agenda, resolution sent to us. David, I believe you called for this to be added. It's a resolution in opposition to the Gang of Eight Senate immigration bill. Would you like this on consent, or would you like this as an agenda item? I believe this was yours.
It's from Surrey County.
From Surrey?
Yeah.
You want to talk about it then? Make it an agenda item?
It's fine.
Okay. We'll add those two. I would like to, from consent, pull the Human Relations Council appointment. Not that I don't support it, but I think with all the discussion, I think we need to clarify a couple of things about that, which I'm in a position to offer. So I'd like that pulled from consent and put on the regular agenda. And what we can do, if the board's okay, is we'll just make the resolutions the first two items after the approval, and then talk about the Human Relations Council appointment, and then go into the public hearing. Mr. Honeycutt, do you have other changes to the agenda?
There's some things that we're going to talk about under county manager's update. There's a pack of information, a couple of budget amendments, and also a lottery request reimbursement. But we'll do that under county manager's report.
Okay, but the budget amendments will be action items that we'll be reviewing. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Commissioners, any other changes to the agenda or consent agenda? If not, then we'll entertain a motion to approve the agenda, which will include the items that remain on the consent agenda. Is there such a motion?
So moved.
Thank you, Bill. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. Tim, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. Let's begin. Henry, if you would come up and just talk about the resolution that's before us. It is short. Maybe let me just, for the benefit of everyone here, if I can just read it. This is a resolution of asking our board to support the sale of the assets of Townsend Umatron to a bidder interested in operating the facility. And Umatron purchased Townsend assets in Chatham County that were in bankruptcy. They included two feed mills, a hatchery with a labor force of over 1,300. And whereas many of the over 125 contract growers' farms were in Chatham County, and whereas Townsend Umatron owns over 300,000 square feet of buildings on over 750 acres in Chatham County, an assessed value of $10 million, They also own equipment valued at $14 million, I'm abbreviating the annual taxes, just under $225,000, and all of the 1,300 jobs have been lost after Omtron ceased operations in September 2011. Contract growers have lost their income stream, whereas the closure of the Pittsburgh plant resulted in a loss of 10% of the town's water customer base, resulting in a revenue shortfall of $230,000. And whereas the closure of the Siler City plant resulted in the loss of approximately 30% of the town's enterprise fund revenue base, leading the town to have to revise its water rate structure so that the typical customer experienced a 30% increase. Whereas the bankruptcy proceedings in the United States District Court for the Middle District of North Carolina appear to be moving toward an auction. Therefore, be it resolved by this board that the bankruptcy court be encouraged to look favorably on any reasonable bid from an entity proposing to restart the poultry operation. Henry, do we have people that are interested in restarting it?
Yes, there's one gentleman that's interested, and that's the reason that I've asked Alamance County to support, you know, the reopening of, you know, someone that would purchase it. And the auction will be now in July. It was supposed to be May, and it was put off. And this is a huge impact to Siler City area, and it's about $9 billion worth of revenue that's lost to that county alone. We also here in Alamance County have several farmers that were contracted with Townsend, which, you know, they've lost their contracts. I was one of those, but I was one of the fortunate ones who was able to pick up somebody else in another contract. The reason for this resolution is to go into a packet with the individual that's interested in purchasing this, so that when the judge comes down to approving the sale that they would take a more interest in someone that would bid toward reopening versus liquidation.
Not just an auction value.
Right. Currently, right now, there's two call the stock and horse bidders. There's one that wants just to buy the land and all the facilities, $5.3 million, I believe it is, and then their Mount Air wants to buy the hatchery at $493,000, and so that's the only two bids that are currently have been put in place. And this gentleman out of Georgia is wanting to open this facility back up and run it. And some of the other municipalities, Pittsburgh, Siler City, and Chatham, and others, they are, and the state is working toward, you know, some kind of incentive package to get this back up and running because of the huge impact, economy impact in that Siler City area. And they'd appreciate the support of this county. We draw off of that base. Our revenues and our economy draws off of that too, because we have people that live here and work in Siler. So that's what it's all about. And if there are any more questions, I'd be glad to answer them.
You willing to amend that to include E-Verify for any workforce they have?
Well, that's a law. You don't have to no more. That's the law.
You sure?
Yeah. That's the law.
What about Rayford Farms? You know, they're doing away with the turkey and they're going to push chickens. How's that going to affect Chatham?
Well, right now, you know, that's in the closing stages, and they don't know. They're saying that they're wanting to move. The poultry industry as a whole is in a growth. So this gentleman is looking to open up and to, like what you would say, a niche market. He's wanting to produce all natural chicken. He has several contracts, and these I can't think of the names of them right now, but he's got several food big wholesale chains, Costco. And he has secured, if he can get this plant running, he's got contracts with them to supply all natural chicken. It's a different market that he's going after. And but we would, you know, it would just be a it'd be a huge blow to that area, along to a lot of our growers here, if that continues to stay closed and doesn't open back up.
Didn't feed prices kill them?
That was part of it, you know, and we don't know exactly what this this guy's from Russia, and he has opportunities to sell this facility three different times and has rejected the sale, and then which has put a bitter taste in several companies. There's been several major companies that wanted to buy this facility and keep it running before it shut down.
You know about the representative from Omtron?
Yeah, the representatives from Omtron.
I hope we can get that thing reopened up.
Well, let me ask, can I ask Clyde, just in general, would the bankruptcy court give preference to someone that would keep it open even if the bid was less than, say, an auction bid, or is that just tough to say?
The bankruptcy court is interested in maximizing the amount of money for the assets. That's why they set this up as what they call a stalking horse bid, which is a guaranteed bid, as it were. It prevents a low bidder from coming in, because this guy that you're talking about, the alternative bidder, he's going to have to put about $200,000 more down in order, because he's going to have to pay $160,000 in fees on the $5.3 million sale before he can bid on it. So as an alternative bidder. But the goal of the bankruptcy court is to get as much money as possible to the creditors. So it's not their it's not really their goal to make sure that something opens up and employs people. Be nice if they would, but
there's nothing else we can do other than decide to support this resolution.
The judge is going to follow the rules, the bankruptcy rules, and take the highest price for the assets.
Is there a motion to support this resolution?
So moved.
Thank you, Bill. David, second. Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Henry, thank you. And thank you for your background
and
explanation
and
of what's going on.
Thank you very much.
And I think it definitely affects Alamance County as well.
It definitely does.
Well, it's not only, you know, not only now, but the competition that it would create, and between the integrators, and you know, the potential of more farms here, you know, farms being able to get contracts. Thank you very much.
Do you think they can operate that if they fully use E-Verify?
Well, they're gonna have to. I mean, according to what the state law is now.
Alamance Hospital, I was up there for dinner. If they got it, I'm really going to be surprised. I didn't hear any English in that section I was in.
Thank you, Henry. The second resolution, this was presented to us from, as David said, Surrey County, and I think it was sent to all the counties, and David asked that we review it. You want me to summarize it here, David, or do you want to talk about it?
Just summarize it. Basically, what it's saying is that Surrey County, and asking Alamance County, of course, to be opposed to the big immigration bill that the U.S. Senate is trying to cram down everybody's throat. And we are suggesting in this resolution that five solutions to the immigration problem, and I'll just read those to you. And that is to end chain migration, and that is when one person, immigrant, comes in, then as soon as they are legally here, supposedly legally, they can bring all of their family in also. And we're asking that particular matter be changed, and to end that chain immigration. Also, verifiable visa entry and exit system. Third, end the visa lottery, which we have now. Fourth, to end this birthright citizenship, which I'm sure you all know that any time a child is born in this country, whether their parent is here or mother is here legally or illegally, they are automatically a citizen. And the fifth solution is to, for the federal government to help states combat our immigration problems. And I think they're very simple. I don't think there's anything too controversial about the solutions that are suggested in it. That's all right.
would you be willing to not only support the resolution but make a motion that this board approve the resolution?
Oh, yeah. I'm sorry. I move that the board approve this resolution.
I'll second.
Any other discussion or comments?
Believe it or not, I'm not going to say a word.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you, David. Want to turn now to the appointment that that I asked to be removed from the consent agenda involving the Human Relations Council. And I appreciate Ms. Kassenbaum describing the role of the council a little bit. I wanted to clarify the appointments that come before this board come from the councils. We don't typically accept, I'll call them off-the-street applications. And I verified this today with the county manager and with Ms. Frank. We received the information last month on an individual who is approved, and the email correspondence came with an endorsement and recommendation for that person. The same with Mr. Carter today. I do have this. The email came from Ms. Alexa Jordan, who is the chair of the Human Relations Council, and basically stating that the referral will be placed on the May 20th agenda for our consideration. And that's today, and that's Steve Carter. I do know Steve. I know Steve in a non-political fashion. I know his role in the political world, as we all have roles. But I also know that Steve's been a banker for over 35 years. He's lived in Alamance County 10 or 11 years. He's been involved in United Way. He's been involved in a lot of the community groups, and knows the area and certainly knows the needs of what we. Of what we're faced with and the challenges that we're faced with. He's been involved in the YMCA. He's been involved, you know, in youth groups, youth committees with this county. So I say that to say I don't personally view this as a political appointment for an extremist group. I think the role of the council, which I believe. And you can have like 24 members, if I'm not mistaken.
25 members.
And I know that you're under that. So getting someone like this from the council for us to review, I think it's a little unfair to pinpoint Mr. Carter as an extremist, which is what I've heard in comments and inferences, even in the newspaper. So I welcome Steve's participation. The council's endorsed it. We all may need to learn a little bit more about what the Human Relations Council does. But if I can make a motion, I'll make a motion that Steve be approved for this appointment.
I'll second that motion.
Thank you. Any other comments? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. And thank you, Steve, for being willing to serve.
You're welcome.
Next item is the reason a lot of you are here, and that is the public hearing on the human service consolidation option. Just briefly, when former Representative Engel stands up, he can tell us about all the background at the state. We're glad you're here, sir. But basically, the state last year did approve a House bill to allow consolidation to a certain level, certain degree of the Department of Social Services and the Department of Public Health. And there are different options available. One option is to not do anything. One is to assume direct control of the board of the two departments by, in essence, abolishing their board. One is to create a consolidated human services agency governed by a consolidated human services board. And one is to create a consolidated human services agency governed directly by the county commissioners. We've heard as a board a little bit about this. The staff has done extensive analysis on it since we first discussed it about 4 months ago. the I think the options are fairly clear. The options also contain the separate option of either participating in what's called the State Personnel Act. The employees may be subject to it, but they may not be. So there's a lot to consider, there's a lot to cover. And again, the purpose of tonight is to hear from you and what your thoughts are. And we're gonna start that. I actually have received a letter from an individual that would serve as a comment. He was not able to attend tonight. He was not feeling well, but I'd like to begin on his behalf and read this as the first comment for the public hearing. I guess I need a motion, though, first to open the public hearing.
So moved.
Thank you, Bill. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? And again, tonight, anyone can speak on this subject as long as you would like. But the subject is related to this public hearing and the consolidation options. So I'm going to be the first speaker. I'm going to put on my Robert Byrd hat. Bob Byrd is one of the senior vice presidents at ARMC, as we know, recently completed their merger with Moses Cone in Greensboro. But here are his comments. I was planning on attending the public hearing on consolidation of health and human health and social services departments and making a few comments, but he's come down with a bug. I guess I didn't need to read that part. Okay, the crux of my thoughts after reading the packet online and reading the press reports over the past weeks or months are these. Number one, ARMC has a great working relationship with both the health department and DSS, and they are both vital to our community. Number two, the current board structure seems to be working great. They ensure that effective governance is performed outside the political arena, and the structure is consistent with the concept of governance through more citizen involvement, as opposed to consolidating more power with a central authority, namely the Board of Commissioners. Number three, consolidation should only be considered if there are clear objectives for doing so. I have not seen any stated. If it is to be more efficient and save operating expenses, no significant savings have been shown. Number one, two, three, four, if it's not broken, why fix it? Number five, whatever scenario is chosen, it makes sense for the staffs to continue under the State Personnel Act to ensure that they can continue to make decisions on potentially very sensitive situations without fear of political concern. These thoughts are mine and do not necessarily reflect the official position of ARMC. However, they are made from my perspective and my leadership position at ARMC with community health responsibilities and from the close working relationship that I've had with the leadership of both agencies for many years. I would greatly appreciate if these comments could be considered as part of the proceedings this evening. Thank you, Robert Byrd, Senior Vice President, ARMC. What I'd like to do is just begin over here, and we'll just start at the back row and come up, and then we'll go over here, and then we'll go into the adjacent room. If you would like to come and speak at this public hearing on consolidation options for DSS and public health. So the last row over there, are any of you interested in speaking on this subject? If not, we'll go to the sheriff's row. I see law enforcement and school people. Steve, your row. Anyone like to speak on this subject? Thank you. We'll go to the back row on this side. Do we have any folks here that would like to speak on consolidation options? Former Representative Engel, we're at your row. Would you like to come speak?
Yes, please.
Please do come, and welcome to you. Glad you're here.
Thank you, Honorable Chair, Honorable Commissioners. It's an honor to be here. I feel for all of you. I know what you're going through this time of year with the budget process and the stressful times. If I could go back just a few years, Mr. Chair, back to about 2007, the local management entity of mental health, the state at that time made a decision to combine the LMEs statewide. They had a minimum population that they went by, and they started these major LME units is what they did, like we're in at this time. Well, their planning was very poor at that time, and because of that, the services were very poor. And I say this to you for a reason. You know, you might say, well, this is like comparing apples to oranges, but it really is not when you think about it. We're taking two very large governmental entities here and place them together. Well, that's okay. That's fine. I'll tell you why it's fine and get back. You talked about the history of this of this law and this bill, if I could get into that just a little bit. This first came up, it was one of the number one things that the Association of County Commissioners wanted to see in 2011. But it kind of sat on the back burner until the 12th hour in 2011 during that session. And all of a sudden, there was a parliamentary procedure that they wanted to do to get it on the front burner in the 12th hour to get it passed. Well, when I saw that, myself and others, we said, wait a minute, we're moving too fast. And I could just go back to the nightmares I had with what happened with our local management entity. So they needed two-thirds of the majority to have a majority to have that parliamentary procedure passed. They did not get that. So that sent it over to the short session in 2012. Well, 2012, they had more time. They tweaked it. They came up with a better product, a better bill. We passed it. I voted for it in 2012. I think it's a good idea. When you look at the things, number one, certainly you want to try to be thrifty and save money for the taxpayers. That's one of the things you want to do. Number two, you want to, if you can help to increase or make the services better, certainly that's something that you want to do. But with that being said, I respectfully say this to you. Take your time. Be deliberate. Make sure you get it right the first time. That's my only, if I may respectfully just give you that advice as you go through this process. Because if you get a bad product, then it can be a mess. I've seen it with the LME, and certainly we don't want that for the county. So I just respectfully would like to say that to you. Now, I have one. I have a 1, 2, and 3. There's one I like better than the others, but I won't give you that unless you ask me. If you ask me, I'll be glad to tell you.
I'm going to ask you.
All right,
I'm
Mr. Sutton.
I think we're all going to ask.
I like number two, and with that, also you may think about this, gentlemen. When it comes to personnel, you're talking about a major thing. You may want to, and you can do this. Go ahead and implement number two. If you decide to vote that way, and then give it a year on the personnel part as you're phasing in, and then the county could be prepared to pick up the personnel part in a year. In other words, that gives you more time to do the study, and then you can jump into picking up the personnel part. So that's a respectful recommendation from me, and I thank you for your time. Thank you.
Thank you, Dan.
Let me ask you something.
Yes, sir.
Representative.
Yes, sir.
The House just passed a bill that the governor is supporting to change the State Personnel Act. Are you aware of that bill?
I am, Judge. I apologize to you. I am not, sir.
I didn't know that you would be.
Yes,
but I just
yes sir.
Wondered if you did.
You yes, know what the changes sir. Are?
The newspaper report said that the changes are to make it easier to terminate state employees.
Greg, do you know?
I'm unaware of. I apologize. We can check on that and get back to you. But I'm unaware of many major changes being considered.
That was just passed, I think, Friday.
Okay.
Thank you. Or Thursday.
We'll check on that for you, sir.
Thank you.
Dan, thank you. Before we go on, Craig, in our package here, you've got the options summarized. Can we put those on the screen so folks can look at that? I see it's one per page, isn't it?
Yeah, I don't think we have it loaded up.
Okay, because I said in summary what they were, but
it's in my letter. It's attached right. to the back.
Right. There okay. is it is in the agenda packet. It is page.
Well, yeah, I have that, but right. I don't know if everybody else has that. But okay, all right, that's fine.
Okay.
Just to clarify, Representative Engel's statement on preference of option two simply says assume direct control of certain local boards by adopting a resolution abolishing the boards, transferring their powers and duties to the county commission. However, appoint a health advisory committee with the same membership currently required for the Board of Health. Representative, is that correct? Is that
yes.
Okay.
Yes.
All right.
Yes. Sir.
All right. Thank you.
May
Ed
I ask
David?
Him another question?
Sure.
May I ask him another? What do you see the difference between one and two, the advantages, disadvantages, one and two?
Those are the two I'm concerned about too, Dan.
Respectfully, I'd have to go back and read them again, Mr. Sutton. I apologize. I focused on that one. I liked it. And so I'd have to go back, and I don't have them in front of me.
That's okay.
All right. I'm sorry. Thank you.
Option one is where this board becomes the board of health and also DSS. That is becomes your function. Option two is the separate board of a combined health and DSS board with the director reporting to the manager.
And you being able to?
Having supervisory. It would not be the board making the personnel decisions. Right. It would be the manager.
Right. And you could fire and hire the director.
Yes, sir.
All right. That's what I thought we'd been talking all along.
Yeah.
You know, the least number option one to me is the least invasive and the easiest to get into. The only thing about it is that employees stay under the State Personnel Act. Otherwise, you keep the same thing. And then this board turns it over to the manager, and they're going to have a director, I assume, on health and the director under social services. But the board has total control, and the manager has total control and has the right to hire and fire the directors of both of those departments. To me, it's the simplest and easiest to get into, just like Dan suggested, you know. And I've always said we don't have to do it all in 1 month. It may take 6 months or a year to get it totally working the way we want it to.
Okay,
the problem I have with number two is you got another board. I mean, it's going to be a gigantic board, and it's going to be hard, I think, to I think the manager will probably have a harder time running the two departments through that director.
And Craig, I don't mind telling you, I'm still a little confused on what we're calling which option, because the options on the screen are a little different than the options you'd given us as background. So
Commissioner,
we're still learning. I know this is a public hearing. Yes.
I have a chart if you want to pass it.
That's the one we have. Yes. Right. Ed, please come forward. Ed Inman, former director of DSS. Welcome, sir.
Good
to see you.
Well, gentlemen, I learned I was going to follow Dan Engel. I got a little nervous, but...
You're better looking than he is.
Thank you. I'm glad you finally recognize that. I do appreciate the opportunity to come and to speak before you. I don't totally agree with what I've heard, but I'll give you my position, my feeling, and hope you'll listen to some degree. It appears to me that there are two main reasons for making any change. One is to save the taxpayers' money. That's been said here tonight. And the other is to make the system more efficient than it is. Well, I suspect that consolidation of social services with health will not result in a cost savings. I've heard nothing to that effect in any of the things I've read. And it will eventually result in some increased, I think, administrative costs. I came here about 32 years ago from up in the mountains back home and I'm not going to bore you with some old stuff. I don't mean to do that, but I want to point one thing out. This is not the first time this has reared its head. I came here about 32 years ago. Larry Scott was the county manager, and one of my first meetings with him was around, can we consolidate human services into a human services department? And we began to look at it from those two perspectives. Will it save money? And will it make the system more efficient? We couldn't find a thing that would do that. So we found no savings in a consolidated system, and we found no way that it would save or make the system more efficient. If memory serves me correctly, the Social Services Department this year, in the coming budget, is asking for less money than it did in its present fiscal year.
Excuse me.
I guess it all comes down to what we can do to make the system more efficient. And I tell you now, I can only speak from social services perspective because I had very little with dealings with the health department except in dealing with programs that we could work together on. But I want to point out something, and I hope these are things that you already know, and I'm just reminding you of, that social services is more than food stamps and Medicaid, a whole lot more. Although they're the most frequently spotlighted programs and make up a large portion of the county's budget, or the social services budget, they're mandated by the state and local rules and federal rules, and are not subject to change, I don't think. But these are not the only programs that are mandated by law and regulation to the Department of Social Services. Social Services provides protective services to children and to adults who are disabled and neglected. They provide foster care, adult care and supervision, rest home and nursing home care, in-home services to prevent long-term care, which is a very expensive procedure. So there are a lot of, and there are many others. I don't want to bore you with going into a long list of these things, but it's a complicated program, and one that requires a great deal of planning and implementation and that comes with my 77 years. So. But I would point out to you that presently, as you know, the programs are overseen by a social services board made up of 5 members. Those 5 members, 2 of which are appointed by you folks, the county commissioners. 2 members are appointed by the state. And those 4 members come together and appoint a 5th member. They have the responsibility and are charged with the awesome responsibility of carrying out these programs efficiently and effectively. I think I pointed out a little earlier that it appears to me that it's pretty efficient when they're not asking for more money, and certainly effective in that I hear very little about children being neglected or abused, or elderly being neglected or abused, or people having problems in these areas. It would appear to me that the department in its present condition and in its present situation is doing the job it's assigned to do. I hope I had over, and I'm not looking for a handshake or a claps or anything like that, but I hope I had something to do with that. This board, this 5-member board, has accepted the awesome responsibility with a sense of pride and with fervor. And I think you're going to find that when you hear David Carter speak. And it's efficient and effective for both the citizens of Alamance County and the client group it represents. And let's not forget, as we look at this situation, the client, the person social services and health serves. When the dust settles, and I'm going to conclude with this, I'm not going to take all night. Some of you know I could talk all night. Some of you dealt with me before. But when the dust settles and you take your vote, I hope you'd allow the Board of Social Services and its dedicated staff to continue providing the needed services to the poor and needy, the abused, the neglected, and the exploited citizens of Alamance County. And with that, I thank you for your time.
Yeah, thank you, Eric. David? Welcome, sir.
Thank you, Commissioners. Word of warning, it's never good to have an open mic for a minister. I think I started out with 22 pages, got down to two, but I still got the 22 in my mind, so.
Can you reenact the 3 minutes?
Yes, we'll see where this goes, but I wanted, for the record, my name is David Carter, and I am the current DSS board chair, and his brother, Ed, I call him Brother Ed because he serves at my church with me, but as he alluded to, I am one of the appointees that you appointed. Not just have I had the privilege to serve on this committee or this board, but you have also appointed me to other committees and boards throughout the county over the last 10 years. During that 10-year tenure, I have had an enormous amount of education to county government, county politics, county budget, some things that I never knew that I liked, some things I wish I never knew and never had to hear about, but they were education none the least. So with that, I sort of got involved over 10 years ago because I was concerned about my county and I was concerned about the citizens within this county. And I've always tried over the years to help make sound decisions that would best help the good citizens of this county, as I believe that's why you were elected as well. It has been a privilege to work alongside of some of the finest people that I've come to know, and those are the county employees. These county employees and these fine people keep services in this county up and running, and they do a great job helping citizens throughout this county. Many of them are concerned about the massive changes that would come from this merger and the stress that would come from placing an already heavy task on them, adding more to them, to their duties that they must perform every day. And you know, when employees talk, being the DSS board chair, I try to listen because they're the ones in the trenches doing the hard work, not myself, not anyone else in this room, but they're the ones every day, as Mr. Inman alluded to, helping the citizens, helping the children, helping the elderly receive services. And as he alluded to, it's more than just food stamps and things of that nature and handing out money or taking children away from parents. It's a lot more than that. It's making sure in the winter that the elderly have heat, in the summer making sure they have air conditioning, and when they can no longer take care of themselves, someone is there representing them, someone is being a ward for them. All these tasks are enormous tasks that these employees carry out every day, and the board oversees that, and the board is important. And as Mr. Inman mentioned, we sort of are in the middle there, helping to balance political decisions that come before us, things that we must vote on a regular basis that affect the citizens of the community. We're there, in a sense, I like to refer to us as a firewall. We're there to help you guys, assist you guys, and protect you guys from many things in the community, and we try to act as that firewall. We're also there for the employees to hear their concerns and their expressions of what they struggle with on a daily basis as they try to meet the needs of the citizens in this fine community. We're also there for the citizens. So when they don't have a voice, as I mentioned, an elderly person who needs a ward, we're there to help and assist in that in any way possible. So upon research of this, when I first heard about it, I actually heard about it from Representative Engel when he was in Raleigh, and I believe made a phone call to me and told me what was coming down the pipe, so to speak. I began to research some of it on my own, and over the last 9 months to a year, as things have been printed in the newspaper and has been discussed in the news, I have learned that less than 12 of the 100 counties in North Carolina have currently sought to implement this merger. I believe 8 are in the process and only 9, I think, have considered it. I believe I'm pretty accurate on that. So less than 12 have sought to implement this merger. When I discovered this, I was puzzled by the fact that this is such a good thing, then why have only a small percentage of these counties decided to implement this? And upon further research, I would suggest that we consider watching and learning from these few counties that are currently doing it. It's my understanding that one of them who have already implemented this have put a stop to it because they've already run into some concerns and problems that Mr. Inman just spoke about. They don't know how they're going to facilitate some of the concerns and the things that would take place, budget increase for administrative cost and various other things. So they have put a stop to it. But at the end of the day, my number one concern is and has always been what is best for the citizens of this county. And of the options that have been discussed that you have seen and that you have before you, I like it just the way it is. And I know sometimes people say, well, it's good to change, and change is good. And as Representative Engel mentioned about mental health, I live that firsthand. And I sought assistance from all of you during that long, drawn-out process. Did not believe in the very beginning stages of it when it was first passed down in Raleigh that it was going to be a good outcome, but the state was forcing our hand and we had to do what was best for this county. And I believe what we have currently up and running for the citizens of the county is a good organization and a good institution. But it is different, as Representative Engel said. You can't compare it. It is an apple and an orange. It is not the same. And combining these two organizations, however you may feel, has some benefits, I still don't see the efficiency part of it or, at the end of the day, the dollar savings that it will bring to the county. I just don't see it. I haven't seen any proof of it, and I believe if it was that big of a deal and there was proof out there, then once again, why is less than 12 counties trying to implement it? Out of the 100 counties, it would seem like numerous ones would be chomping at the bits to jump in there and to try this, but many are sitting back to wait and see. And I preferably don't want to be the test dummy. Speaking on behalf of social services, I don't want to be the county that does it and crashes and burns. I think it would be better if we just watched some of the other ones. There's a large county or two that are participating in it. There's some smaller rural counties that are participating in it. And I would respectfully suggest that we just watch and see, table it and just see what happens. And as we learn, I'm not saying that there's not something that could be tweaked or done better down the road, but I think we could learn a lot by other people's mistakes instead of making them on our own. Thank you for your time. I appreciate once again the opportunity to serve the county.
Thank you, David. You either have really large paper or really small print font. I'm not sure which.
22 pages in the head.
Chief, I'd like to speak. Dana? Okay, row where Van, Peggy, Jim, come forward.
I thought you was going to speak, Peggy.
Mr. Allen, welcome to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Tom, for and the rest of you for at least considering to hear this. I'm going to get shaken now because we've done heard people that want to hold on to the control. I want the control to go to my county commission, which is the buffer zone. You just heard a preacher tell you he'd protect you and be your buffer zone. I'm speaking for people all over this state. I'm speaking for Better Child North Carolina, a group of people from all over this state. Man, from what I just heard here, it just makes me mad. And I wished I could spill it out, but in front of everybody, I can't. I'm just mad. Take this control. Take the control where you guys have the control. You've sat here and heard, we're taking care of the people. We're doing this. Well, sir, I'd like to know where you were at over the summer when I went down to social services and there was a 50-year-old woman in the hospital, or any of you. Because guess what? The reality is I'm a congressional candidate. Yeah, a federal congressional candidate. And I couldn't get no answers. What do you think the average Joe's getting out there? This woman right now is in a mental hospital down here at AMRC. I couldn't even get nobody to step in for this woman. Now, I'm not going to sit here privately. I would love to give each one of you this story of hell and horror that I went through. And as far as the hospital guy that just sent you the note, on my phone, my mother was just in the hospital. She's dying of cancer. Do we want to hear more of the PhD crap? Where was he at when they had my mother being diagnosed and told she was going to die of cancer down here at this hospital, photographs to prove it, kept overnight in a room that had soiled linens in it? Gentlemen, call down to the hospital. You're going to get the same thing. This is what I deal with. Misery and despair. I don't sit up in a church. No offense, I'm a Christian, but I'm not insulated from nothing. I see the hell in this world. That's who I get all the telephone calls from. I get calls from the mother who's lost their child. I get calls from Louisiana and a little boy abducted in Egypt. That's what I get. I get all the misery and suffering. And I am sick of the piled higher and deeper PhD BS. Empower us. Take control of this. Now I don't even know whether I'm coming or going, but after this, I got some stories I'd like to tell you. I've got pictures that I'd like this hospital guy to see that seems to think that everything's okay. I got a story that I'd like to tell the minister back here that seems to think that protecting you, you guys don't need it. If you guys have a problem, they're going to listen to you. What in the world? But the guy down here and the guy over here in the Section 8 and the guy out here that has no place to live tonight, who's listening to them? These guys aren't doing it. No offense. It's just truth-telling time. Now, please consider. I think you need to do what Mr. Engel said. Take your time with this. But quit listening to the piled higher and deeper PhD crap. Because the bottom line is they're sitting in offices and they don't know jack diddly about squat. And they're getting paid handsomely for it. Most of them are. And it's ridiculous. Thank you so much. I'm very sorry. I don't usually get worked up like this. But by God, this has got to stop. From Washington to Main Street. Jesus. Is anybody going to start thinking here? Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mr. Allen.
Mark? Everybody? Everybody good? Monty, would you mind seeing?
Yeah, come, but
can you go see if there's people over there, kind of get them lined up also?
Yes.
Thank you. Good evening.
Good evening. How are you? I'm happy to be here today, and I'd like to thank all of you. But I have a concern. I'm vice chair of the planning committee.
I'm sorry, can you introduce yourself?
Yes, I'm Grace Baldwin. I thought everybody knew me.
A lot of people out there that
with
may
the
not.
Hat most of the time.
Thank you, Ms. Baldwin.
I'm with the planning committee of Alamance County and also vice chair of the adult committee in Alamance County, the elder care. And I'm an advocate for elders. And I'm on the legislative of AARP. So I have very concern about our elders. And when you say combining, our elders have to wait. Elders are always in the back burner, seem to be. And I have a concern on the health problems of the elders. Now, we all know that sometimes they have to wait on heat, where our young persons, you know, they get their heat vouchers. And I've been told that the elders have to go to the doctor and get permission whether they're sick or near death before they get their heat vouchers. And I feel that we need to have a great concern when you start combining health and considering our elders. We need elders to be first or be recommended in some kind of form, shape, that they will get taken care of. I've seen the elders suffer. And just like the gentleman said, I've seen my parents suffer. And their needs weren't met because of the long lines. And we have to say we're putting more burdens on the Department of Social Service also because you're overloading people working. You're going to combine all these things together and have consideration for your employers also because they're hired to do a good job and let them do a good job by not overloading them. So that's all I have to say.
Thank you, Ms. Baldwin. Chris, Patsy, Tony, anybody want to speak?
Welcome.
Good afternoon, or good evening. I'm here as Patsy Simpson, the citizen, not with the Board of Education. For those of you who don't know, I have been a foster parent here in Alamance County for the last, I guess, 16 or 17 years, and have had the privilege of having probably 25 to 30 foster children in my home. I interact with the Department of Social Service on a regular basis. As a matter of fact, as I hold this phone in my hand tonight, it's because I'm waiting to get a phone call of a delivery of a two-day-old baby who will be staying with me hopefully sometime tonight. So I say this with a lot of compassion because I deal with Department of Social Service on a weekly, if not a daily basis. And I can talk from the standpoint of just staffing in general. I may see a social worker once a month if I do not have a court hearing with my children. I think about those who may not be in a home such as myself and the limited amount of time due to staffing and seeing a social worker once a month. Once they do come, I'm very impressed with the social workers that I have. But over the last few years, I've seen just a revolving door. As a matter of fact, when I was there today, I saw a group going in and I responded, wow, there's a lot of new people here. I used to know a lot of them by names, but unfortunately, they're not able to retain them. My concern is with the combined health department and social service, how frequently will they be able to meet with me or my children? I provide the day-to-day care, but the social worker is needed to keep that connection between the child and the parents and the many services that a lot of these children need, whether that's health care, educational needs, mental health needs. But I'm just so afraid that if the two are combined and combined with the expectation that you're going to somehow have fewer employees, then I believe that the services will dwindle and that we will not be in a position to provide the services for the children that they need. I have truly been blessed with the children that I have and have that time to devote, but some foster parents don't have that time. I can take my children to school. I can take them to a lot of medical appointments, dental appointments, and have that one-on-one time. There are some foster parents that they work 9 to 5, and therefore they rely upon the Department of Social Service to do a lot of the transport that I personally do myself. I would hope that you would take some time to seriously think about this, look at some of the other departments who have, in fact, combined. It's not just about the governing board, but it's about the services that are provided on a day-to-day basis. And I would hope that you would look at those services to ensure that those services would not be diminished in any way, because they are at bare minimum standards as they are now. I applaud Susan Osborne, the Department of Social Service, the court systems that work with the children, but please don't do anything that would hamper the services, because they are very, very minimum. And it really takes really good supportive parents who have that time in order to make up now for some of those differences in services that the department can't do. And unfortunately, everyone don't have a schedule such as I to do that. So just take some time and look, get down to the nitty gritty and look at what services are being provided and how this merger would affect that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Simpson. Excuse me. Good evening. Come forward.
Good evening, commissioners. I bring you greetings from Healthy Alamance, where I serve as the executive director, and thank you for the opportunity to speak tonight about consolidation. Can you hear me?
You might want to tell everybody who you are.
They couldn't hear me?
No, they hear you, but you might want to tell everybody who you are.
So as I said, I'm April Durr with Healthy Alamance, where I serve as the director, and I'm thankful to be here tonight to speak on consolidation. Healthy Alamance is a local nonprofit where I serve, and my office is actually at the health department, and I'm an employee of the hospital. We have a long history of facilitating collaborative work in Alamance County, where we work hand in hand with the hospital, the health department, and social services, as well as many other nonprofits affiliated with United Way. But one of the main projects that we share our collective success is our comprehensive community assessment, and this is a requirement under the consolidated agreement for the health department. Most recently, this document has been highlighted as one of for others to follow in the state. So out of 100 counties, ours shined as one to follow as a model because of our thoughtful planning and because of our clear sense of braided initiatives. So I wanted to note this example as well as two others that I think will help in this situation. Project Launch is another example where we have seen great work with social services, the health department, mental health coming together to look at the needs of the county. We're the only county in the state receiving this grant. Another noteworthy example is our statewide leadership, where we've received awards from the governor's task force to eliminate the work in vulnerable populations dealing with health disparities. So I mention these three things because I believe they showcase and highlight how thoughtful planning pays off and how collaboration is already taking place here in Alamance County. I could definitely talk a lot longer about the work that we're doing, but I could be here all night, and I'm pretty sure you all are familiar with the work that the county is doing with their partners. But I think that these examples could be a foundation for the decision at hand, which is consolidation. The health department and social services have numerous services to provide and specific regulations to follow when they serve their public in their shared space on Graham Hopedale Road. Their respective duties of their boards have laws to uphold, and their work is always non-biased and it's non-political. So you have a critical decision to make when it comes to consolidation. So I urge you to really look closely at the options and look at closely what each board does and carefully consider all of the options so that we can really continue to shine in Alamance County and continue to do the great work that we're doing in partnership with one another. If consolidation proves to be the most effective and efficient choice without jeopardizing the services that the public receives from these entities, then I'm really confident that you all will find in your due diligence of research that there will be a planned out and implementation before anything is done very quickly. So this is a decision for you all to make. I just wanted to come tonight to show my support, to offer any assistance, and to remind you of the good work that's being done in Alamance County thus far and how we're already really working hand in hand together to save dollars and to have a bigger impact so that Alamance County can continue to shine in our state. So I really appreciate the opportunity to speak, and thank you again. Good luck with your decision. If there's anything I can do to help, please let me know.
Thank you, April. Do we have any more speakers for the public hearing? Thank you, Mike. If not, then I will look for a motion that we close the public hearing at this time. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Thank you. Bill, David, all in favor say aye to close the public hearing. Any opposed? Public hearing is now closed. Before we go to the next item, any comments or directives to our county manager from the commission as far as where we would like to go from here on this subject?
I'd like to hear from the commissioners. Where do we want to go?
I want a clarification between one and two as to who can fire and who can hire. I mean, the directors. There seems to be a little bit of confusion on that.
Let me pull it. There it is. All right. Option two is the manager hires and fires, and that's with the consolidated board. Option one is where the board hires and fires, and the board serves as that the consolidated board.
Which board fires and hires?
Board? Yes.
The board can also delegate that responsibility to the manager under number one.
I like number one.
I do too.
I'm going to make the motion that we accept number one as our.
Well, I want to hear more about what our duties with you.
Okay.
Please.
Okay.
Every duty that, as far as, you know, you still would have the health advisory board and they would make advisory recommendations to the Board of Commissioners who would serve as a consolidated board. But you would have to then, you know, begin doing all the approvals and the same agendas that the current Health Department Board has and also the DSS Board. So you would serve anything that needed approval that those boards are doing now would fall back upon the Board of Commissioners.
Will we have separate meetings other than what we do here?
It would depend on the time. You know, how long, you know, not sure the time frame of how long they normally would run, how long a consolidated meeting or consolidated agenda would take.
What's the disadvantage of two versus one? I mean, of doing one or doing two and not doing one?
I think it's one of the things that, Commissioner Smith said, you do create another board under option two, you know, but instead of having two boards, you have one board.
I mean, you'd be going from a health board, social service board down to
one board.
One.
Right.
It looks like, on number two, it says manager hires, supervises, terminates directors, director with advice and consent of the board. I don't want that. I don't want the board to make those decisions. I want the county manager. In my opinion, the county manager should be the one making those decisions, not a board that, you know, that doesn't understand all the things that's involved in that decision.
Would it be less of that with one versus two?
Brian, I may have said something incorrect.
No, I was just going to say that in option one, the departments do not consolidate. So it's option two, the departments are put together, health and DSS, and become one department. And option two, there's one board between the Board of Commissioners and the new consolidated department. In option one, the departments do not consolidate. The board would be abolishing both boards of health and the Board of DSS, assuming those duties, but the departments would not become one.
Thank you.
The difference on your chart here between option one and the other two is the state personnel is mandatory under option one. Does that mean mandatory that they're covered under that? Is that right, Craig?
Yes, that is correct.
And
yes.
They're not under option, or it's optional under option two or option
right.
three.
Right. It is, and we have done, you know, we asked the Attorney General for an opinion if our current system would be, you know, what is the word called? Equivalent. It's
well,
substantially equivalent.
We hadn't heard from the Attorney General, have we? Has
no.
He not replied?
We've asked
months?
Twice. But
well, three times.
Three
actually.
Times. But in doing our review, we feel like that our personnel policy is substantially equivalent to the state personnel, so it would be the option of the board.
I'm still of the opinion the governor is going to get the legislature to change it. The House has already passed it. The governor is pushing it, and I think it's going to happen. I may be wrong, but I think it's going to happen.
In your homework analysis so far, does the staff have a recommendation?
The concern that we would have, and this is a board issue, would be the amount of information that is brought to the board for approval. Since you would serve for both, you would serve as the, you know, both boards. You know,
under which option are you saying?
That is option.
I mean, what you just said, your reservation is related to option one.
That is, you know, that would be a concern. I think the board would have to weigh is how much information and decision making that you would like to do dealing with both departments under option one.
It seems to me that under option one, you're going to have the least amount of change because basically each department is going to stay the same way. They're just coming under the board, i.e. the manager for total supervision. And it's going to, I think the employees would prefer it over the second option. And I think most of the two departments would probably prefer that also.
I definitely want to merge. The biggest thing I had was I wanted to be able to fire and hire the directors. Because, and off, no offense, the political correctness that comes off both boards is just unreasonable, totally unreasonable. Can't get a straight answer sometimes. It just, and that drives me up a wall. I was on the Social Services Board for 2.5 years, didn't miss a meeting, and I'd never seen anything to beat, frankly. And I had to leave to where I could look at it independently. But I'm in favor of one of the options here. I'm not going to obviously vote no to stop it. You know, I want to merge it where we have control of the directors.
I'll make the motion that we accept number one option to be our director.
Second.
All right, we have a motion and a second. Are there any other comments? I have two comments. I'm still not convinced that I understand the difference between these options, nor do I understand what staff is saying is the most workable, nor, and a couple of comments were made tonight, other than the issue of the management, which is important. I don't know that we've analyzed, at least I haven't seen the analysis on what the savings are, both quantitatively and with respect to lack of duplication of departments, you know, 3 HR areas, purchasing departments, and so forth. And the second reservation I have is, I really feel uncomfortable doing this without getting the input from Linda Massey, because she serves on both boards. So those are my reservations, which is why I'm probably not going to vote for anything tonight. But there is a motion and a second.
Let me say this. She's obviously made it clear she wasn't going to support either option. But I can't. I think she's made that clear. The only thing I like two for, David and Bill, myself, the motion's on the floor, and I'll vote for it. But you had a chance. We had a chance to have a more professional board. As far as, you know, I've always felt the health board was probably more professional. I think you have to have certain doctors on there. You have to have vets. You have to have a little bit of everything. The social services board, I was there for 2.5 years, seemed to be more of a token board. Really didn't have, in my opinion, much influence on, you know, policy or work ethic or whatever. It's just a token, in my opinion, token board. And I saw two as an option to have a very professional board for both. And with us, I don't know how that's going to play out.
Tim, under option one, we would have to appoint a public health advisory committee.
That's basically what they got now. And you'd have to use the same guidelines for the health department.
What, social now. Services?
Nothing.
Nothing would be appointed. Hmm. Just us.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, I'm going to support the motion. You know, like I say, I think two might have been more.
I call for the question.
Okay, we have a motion and a second for option one. Dave, is that correct?
Yeah.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? I'm going to vote no. That motion passes 3-1.
Mr. Chairman, if would you want to look at a time frame for implementation? You know, because we're going to have to get in looking at board requirements, and if you know, I think we want to make sure you're fully aware of the responsibilities. You know, we kind of stopped in our tracks because there were so many options. Now that we have that focus on this option, it's going to take some time from implementation. So we will begin working on that and try to give you a time frame at a later date, if that's okay.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
And I would also like to start seeing some of the quantifiable analysis, where we're going to, what's going to happen? What are we going to gain? What are we going to save? Why are we doing it?
Can we take a short break?
Yes, and thanks to all of you who are here for the public hearing. We'll take about a 5-minute break. Kathy, then we'll have you back here and talk about the grant funds. We'll talk about the recommended budget for next fiscal year. Thank you all. Okay.